Good afternoon. Could I ask the members of the public in the gallery if they could please now cease their conversations till you get outside the building, because we're about to restart our proceedings. Thank you very much indeed for your cooperation. The next item of business is a members' business debate on motion 10188 in the name of Paul Sweeney on free bus travel for people seeking asylum. This debate will be concluded without any questions being put, and I would ask those members who would wish to speak in the debate to please press the request to speak buttons, and I call on Paul Sweeney to open the debate.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. In December 2021, alongside ambassadors from the Voices Network, who are in the gallery today, I launched a campaign for free bus travel for people seeking asylum here in Scotland. Since then, the campaign has attracted widespread support from across the asylum sector and from third sector organisations such as Mariel Integration Network, Min Voices, the Scottish Refugee Council, Just Right Scotland, Grampian Regional Equality Council, and Friends of Scottish Settlers, amongst others. On top of that, there is cross-party support in this Parliament. This week, the Equality, Human Rights and Civil Justice Committee backed the extension of the National Concessionary Bus Scheme to asylum seekers on a countrywide provision, calling the policy transformative. I also thank Mr Dorris, in particular, the member for Glasgow Maryhill and Springburn, and Mr Ruskell, the Green member for Mid-Scotland and Fife Region, for their continued cross-party efforts in support of this campaign. In my own region of Glasgow, the cost of an all-day bus ticket is £5. People seeking asylum do not have the right to work, and therefore they rely on a financial allowance of just £6 per day to cover the cost of living. And for those living in provided hotel accommodation, an ever-increasing number, the allowance can be as little as £1.36 per day. Having to fork out £5 for bus travel to attend medical, social, legal appointments or even urgent Home Office appointments is simply not an option unless they go without food or other essentials. Asylum accommodation is often situated in isolated areas of cities with the lowest rents and unaffordable public transport systems ultimately compound the isolation for many new Scots. Concessionary bus travel is therefore a key social justice policy that has the ability to positively transform the lives of those stuck in the dreadfully slow and inadequate asylum system presided over by the Conservative-run Home Office. People seeking asylum are amongst the most vulnerable people in our society, forced to live in squalid conditions on next to no money, prevented from getting a job to earn money despite often being highly qualified, and despite being eminently capable people able to contribute so much to our communities. The difficulties faced by people seeking asylum in Scotland lies firmly at the door of the Conservative UK government. However, the Scottish government has the ability to improve the lives of asylum seekers in many practical ways. Free bus travel would enable people seeking asylum to explore and integrate in their new home country. It would also vastly improve their quality of life, with the cost of bus travel eating up the already scarce amount provided by the Home Office for essentials. As mentioned in my opening remarks, the third sector and the asylum sector are right behind this campaign, but I think it's important to draw attention to the support from wider civic society too. Indeed, all faith leaders in the Scottish Religious Leaders Forum have signed an open letter in support of the policy, and the Mental Health Foundation and the Poverty Alliance have also recommended the proposal. I've been pleased to work on a cross-party basis with parliamentary colleagues, engaging with the Scottish Government on this ask, liaising directly with successive transport ministers and with the Transport Scotland Agency. I also personally met with the Deputy First Minister in her previous role as Cabinet Secretary for Social Justice, Housing and Local Government, and with the Cabinet Secretary for Wellbeing, Economy, Fair Work and Energy in his previous role as Minister for Culture, Europe and International Development with special responsibility for refugees, both of whom saw merit in the proposals. Following the commitment in the programme for government in 2022-23 to work with the third sector partners and councils to consider how best to provide free bus travel, a 12-week trial took place earlier this year in Glasgow. There was no mention of a national rollout of free bus travel for asylum seekers in the programme for government in 2023-24, which came as a disappointment to those who have worked on this campaign for almost 2 years now. Now is the time to implement this on a full-time basis, Deputy Presiding Officer. The Scottish Government is already providing concessionary travel through the Young Person Scheme and the Older and Disabled Person Scheme. The framework is there and can be easily extended. First, happy to give way.
Jackson Carlow.
Mr Sweeney will be aware that this is the subject of an active petition before the Public Petitions Committee. It has drawn cross-party support, and it was an issue that I put directly on behalf of the committee and the petitioner to the First Minister when he appeared before the conveners group just before the October recess. In that, he gave a very strong commitment to look into seeking to deliver the aims of the petition. Is he pleased at least with that progress to date? And is he hopeful, like me, that the Minister might be able to advance the First Minister's commitment beyond that that he was able to give in June?
Paul Sweeney.
Well, as an alumnus and evangelist for the work of the Citizens' Participation Public Petitions Committee, I commend the member for Eastwood in his capacity as convener of that committee in putting that question to the First Minister at the recent session with him. And I'm pleased that there's encouraging responses from the First Minister, and hopefully the Minister has heard those remarks too and will respond in due course. First Bus, which also serves the Eastwood constituency, is the largest bus operator in Scotland and indeed in Glasgow, which is the highest asylum dispersal area in the United Kingdom. They have confirmed that they would support any mechanism that would offer travel assistance to displaced people, providing that provisions were reviewed and tied to a reimbursement rate similar to the existing concessionary travel schemes. And I've had recent correspondence with the Transport Minister in which she committed to looking further into this, and indeed the First Minister, as mentioned by the Member for Eastwood, has said that he's actively considering this matter. I therefore urge the Minister to update Parliament today on whether the Government will make an order in exercise of the powers conferred by the Transport Scotland Act of 2005 to establish a national bus travel concession scheme for those people seeking asylum in Scotland, as defined by Section 94 in the Immigration and Asylum Act of 1999. Extending the free bus travel scheme on that basis is well within the Scottish Government's gift. Supplementing the existing concessionary travel schemes will cost a fraction of the overall Scottish budget, and the change can be brought in at speed and at pace, providing quick relief to those seeking asylum here in Scotland. Frankly, for such small change, it would make a huge difference to thousands of lives. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr Sweeney. I now call COCAP Stewart to be followed by Douglas Lumsden. Ms Stewart.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I'm grateful to Paul Sweeney for bringing this debate to the Chamber. I also note that a petition on this very issue has been lodged in this place, and clearly there is public momentum behind this campaign, and I know that the Scottish Government will be listening very carefully. We know that the financial burden associated with bus travel is an obstacle for many asylum seekers, and I also welcome the pilot schemes and urge the Government to carefully consider the recommendations that arise from them, such as the one conducted by the Refugee Survival Trust and also by First Bus, supported by Grampian Regional Equality Council and the Scottish Refugee Council. Earlier this week, as has been referred by Paul Sweeney, in my capacity as convener, I announced the publication of the Equalities, Human Rights and Civil Justice Committee report into the inquiry of lived experience of asylum seekers in Scotland. The committee heard very clearly from them regarding this issue, and therefore includes a strong recommendation in our report on the expansion of the National Travel Concessionary Scheme to include asylum seekers. And I hope that this lends further weight to calls for what would make a huge difference to the lives of asylum seekers. Understanding that immigration and employment are reserved matters, the committee did write to the UK Immigration Minister, Mr Jenrick MP, inviting him to give evidence on three separate occasions, but no reply was received. Disrespectful to say the least, I would say. But once again, it falls on the Scottish Government to mitigate, but we can in this place provide action to back up our message of welcome and support for asylum seekers. Now, Presiding Officer, what I can say will never be as powerful as the words of the asylum seekers themselves. So, therefore, I will take my time to give voice to their words. Words that have been given to me in a statement by asylum seekers working with the Maryhill Integration Network, and I read them verbatim. We are writing this statement as a collective of people who are currently in the asylum process, in communities and in hotels, accommodation across Scotland. Free bus travel will provide us with the opportunity to travel, especially to appointments crucial to our asylum claims, such as with our lawyers. Hotels feel like open prisons, And although we can leave, we have no funds to do so. Being confined into one space has also led to a decline in our mental health well-being, as we are left alone with nothing to do because we don't have the right to work. The free bus travel will also allow us to integrate into the community, to volunteer, attend colleges, classes, places of worship, so that we can become familiar with our new surroundings and home. The current asylum support is only enough to cover our food and essential needs. So some of us who are unable to walk for long distances due to medical reasons may need to prioritise spending the allowance on transport. We want to contribute to society by volunteering. We want to gain new skills and we want to have the choice to travel. We are individuals with experience and education, and most importantly, we are human. Humans that have gone through hardship, struggle, and even persecution. And with this free bus travel, we will have some degree of freedom during our very difficult immigration process. The immigration system is stressful with many difficulties. With free bus travel in Scotland for such a small change, it will have a huge difference for us all. Their words, Presiding Officer, and I need not say anything further.
Thank you, Ms Stewart. I now call Douglas Lumsden to be followed by Stuart McMillan. Mr Lumsden.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and thank you to Paul Sweeney for bringing this important debate today. This is a timely issue and one that this Parliament is right to discuss. As we've heard, many organisations have raised this issue as a matter of concern, and it's from members' debates like this that we become more informed and start asking some serious questions. We've also heard that it's also a subject of a live petition, so there obviously will be progress in this area. In preparation for today's debate, I read through the recently published committee report, and I also read the Travel Choices report that we received last night. Both reports highlight benefits to asylum seekers, but it's clear more work needs to be done. We do need to understand the costs of such a measure. The bus companies would need to be reimbursed from somewhere. We need to understand if it's an issue in rural areas such as the North East and Highlands more than urban areas. We need to understand how we identify those that may be eligible for such a scheme. And we need to understand how this benefits those in rural areas where bus services are few and under-resourced. And I guess also that government may have choices around options that they could provide in such a scheme, you know, whether travel would be limited by ticket price or distance, or whether it should be an unlimited scheme to allow asylum seekers to travel right across Scotland. Presiding Officer, there's, as we've heard, still many unanswered questions, and it's imperative that the Scottish Government looks into this into greater detail, as the committee report calls on them to do. I know the Assembly in Wales has taken similar action, so it should be possible for us to learn from their experience and be able to evaluate such a scheme prior to considering it in Scotland. I fully appreciate the calls from many charities and faith groups to introduce this scheme here. It feels like a simple thing that we can do to help those who are fleeing persecution. However, we have to understand better the implication on finances for the public and potential implications on our local government colleagues. With so many strains on public finance, we need to be sure that this is the right thing to do at this time. We also need to have people's asylum applications dealt with faster. I did note from the Travel Choices report that one of the asylum seekers that took part in the pilot had been here for 20 years without a decision being made. Presiding Officer, the cost to the public, the cost to the public of transport in Scotland is high. Bus fares and train fares are high, and we need to work together to ensure that transport is not a barrier to accessing vital public services and support. I appreciate that Mr Sweeney is a member for Glasgow, so the focus on this motion is on that city, but representing a rural region such as mine brings different challenges and priorities. And I'd like to know whether such
a scheme would actually help asylum seekers when rural bus services are under such pressure and so sparse. I'll give way.
Paul Sweeney.
Thank the member for giving way, and he's making a series of fair points. Would you also note, however, that the total number of asylum seekers currently present in Scotland as of March this year was only just over 5,000, so it is a relatively small number of people that we are talking about, so it's a fairly marginal increase in the current entitlements in the current schemes.
Douglas Lumsden.
Absolutely, I recognise that, but of course, you know, we're often challenged here where money is going to come from, so it would be good to know the overall cost. I'm sure it's not going to be huge, and it's surely something that we can implement. Presiding Officer, in closing, I would like to echo the final paragraph in the statement by the faith communities, who have also called for this to be introduced, and commend the work of the third sector in Scotland, who carry so much of the burden in our social care sector. Their statement says that they look to a hopeful future in Scotland, where everyone has the opportunity to thrive and contribute to their communities. This is a sentiment that we can all agree with. I do agree that it's something that the Scottish Government should be looking more closely at, getting accurate costings, considering where that money should come from and how a system would actually work. And they must also consider the implications on our rural communities, because one size probably won't fit all, but I'm sure it's something we can overcome. So I thank Mr. Sweeney for raising this today and look forward to discussing this further as we go through this whole process. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Lumsden. I now call Stuart McMillan to be followed by Paul O'Kane. Mr. McMillan.
Thank you very much. First of all, I'd like to thank Paul Sweeney for bringing this debate forward. I want to live in a Scotland where we treat everyone who lives within our borders with dignity and respect. I will gently remind Paul Sweeney about his party's Chequered position on immigration, but something both Mr. Sweeney and I can agree on is the Tories at Westminster have ripped up the rule book when it comes to treating people with compassion, particularly people seeking asylum. The rhetoric from Suella Braverman and Robert Jenrick, amongst others, has been nothing short of appalling, and it has made bringing forward policies like and proposals like free bus travel for people seeking asylum more challenging. But no doubt there will be people watching this debate who disagree with this motion, saying the money could be better spent elsewhere. But we also know that the Scottish Government budget has consistently been cut, and it certainly is tight, to say the least. However, I think many will have been taken in, sadly, by the rhetoric from the UK Government and will not appreciate that we're talking about a very small number of people. As Paul Sweeney indicated a moment ago, it's around about 5,000 people. Also, I've met many of the asylum seekers in my constituency, along with the local MP, Ronnie Cowan. The hotel being used to accommodate them initially had a maximum capacity of 80, but this has recently been increased to 160, doubling up strangers in rooms. And there's no extra money coming from the UK Government to actually help deal with and provide local services as a consequence. Now, the asylum seekers want a home of their own, and they also want to contribute to society, as many have the skills that many local businesses and also the public sector could actually utilise. But instead, they are left to find things to do day after day to then return to their room without their family. Until you've experienced this or witnessed the life asylum seekers are living, nobody could really fully understand what they're going through mentally. They are human beings, often coming from war-torn countries. The Scotland I believe in is a warm and open country that welcomes people that also want to come here and create new lives for themselves. And organisations like Your Voice in my constituency are doing a great job in actually trying to help the asylum seekers in the Greater Inverquhy constituency. I'm very proud of my constituency and the job that they have done, and actually kind of opening up the hand of friendship and being very warm and welcoming to the asylum seekers. However, the fact that asylum seekers are moved around the country on a regular basis without any choice, that makes it a lot harder for certainly my community, but also for other communities where asylum seekers are. I spoke to one man who, in the space of 15 months, has moved from a hotel in Northern Ireland to three more in Scotland, and then also coming to Greenock. That is no way to live. That's an existence. And that's why I fully support providing free bus travel for people seeking asylum, as it might make life just a wee bit easier for them to actually get around. Sure.
Jackson Carlow.
And clearly asylum seekers under 25 and over a certain age will already be eligible for the free bus travel. My understanding is not an issue of principle with the government. It's an issue of practical implementation in that they have to identify a cohort of individuals in a transparent and measurable way to extend the scheme to. That's what I'm hoping that the Minister might be able to advance us on. I think we're agreed in the principle. It's the actual practical way in which it might be implemented.
Stuart McMillan.
Well, I'm sure the Minister will deal with the matter, because it wasn't a question for me. Presiding officer, I've witnessed men locally also supporting each other with that language barrier. And if one person speaks Arabic and is well spoken in English, that person can then become a helpful conduit for the rest of the group. And this certainly can be very important when needing to raise an issue or seek help, particularly when it comes to reading letters, formal letters that come in. Presiding officer, asylum seekers receive a very small allowance each week, £9.58 if someone is staying in a hotel. And certainly in my constituency, asylum seekers are staying in hotels. And as we already know, I mean, it's not a huge amount of money, particularly when it does cost comes to the issue of the cost of travel. But so I believe that for a relatively low cost, the benefit of free bus travel to asylum seekers would be truly game-changing, and certainly would reflect the different approach that we could take in Scotland with supporting those in need. But I do go back to my point. I know that the finances are extremely tight, to say the least. However, disabled asylum seekers aged between 22 and 59 may experience some issues in accessing the current concession of travel scheme, as their eligibility may be dependent on the receipt of certain UK welfare benefits which asylum seekers cannot access. So the Equalities, Human Rights and Civil Justice Committee report published this week, and so Co-Cab Stewart, the convener, spoke in this debate, already stated that, in a quote from the report, sorry, a quote from one of the asylum seekers who told the committee, "When I'm stressed, everything about me goes down, so bus passes would be a big help." Saying also in concluding, I actually do welcome the committee's findings, and an extension of the existing national concession scheme to include all asylum seekers would be transformative. And I do hope that the Scottish Government would consider this during the upcoming budget process, but also recognise it will be extremely difficult to do so. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms McMillan. I now call Paul O'Kane to be followed by Mark Roscoe. Mr O'Kane.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer, and can I begin by thanking my friend Paul Sweeney for bringing this debate today and indeed pay tribute to his long-standing work on this issue and indeed issues more widely impacting people seeking asylum, both in this place and in the House of Commons and indeed in the communities of Glasgow, which he represents. The issue we are debating, as we've already heard today, sits in the context of the Illegal Migration Act and the backlogs in asylum processing, which demonstrate, I think, a lack of support or dignity indeed afforded to people seeking asylum from the many dangerous situations which they find themselves in their country of origin. I've spoken on this subject on behalf of these benches in our debates on the Act when it was a bill, and indeed my view of the callous approach taken by the UK Conservative Government in that Act. And that is why it is vital, Deputy Presiding Officer, that the Scottish Government uses the powers and resources it has at its disposal to alleviate the structural problems that people seeking asylum face living in Scotland. And access to transport, as I think we've already heard, is one of those the most fundamental and basic barriers where we can help. We've heard already that asylum seekers are not allowed to work and therefore have to live off an allowance that amounts to only £6 a day. And obviously that leads to there being little money left for travel once basic essentials like food are taken into account. And we should make no mistake, travel is essential. Seeing a GP, speaking to a solicitor, attending support appointments, seeking advice, or just seeing other people to feel like you have a sense of community. Those are all fundamental things that everyone in this chamber takes for granted. And of course, it is no different for those seeking asylum. The Equalities, Human Rights and Civil Justice Committee, which I sit on, has heard a lot of evidence on this subject over the past year through our inquiry work into asylum seekers in Scotland, and has highlighted the issue of free bus travel in the report, as we've heard from colleagues already. Indeed, the report just last week made very clear recommendations on this issue, and I think the evidence within it was very compelling. And I know that along with committee colleagues, I was greatly moved by the evidence that we heard both formally and informally about the impact that a lack of access to travel has on people.
And it was particularly helpful during our work to visit the Maryhill Integration Network and hear directly from people experiencing those barriers on a daily basis. And I thank my colleague, the convener, Cocob Stewart, for taking the time in her remarks to share very directly some of those experiences. I will add to that with some of the formal evidence that we heard. Indeed, Pinar Aksu of the Integration Network told us informal evidence that it would make life a little easier for people who live in such horrific conditions, and that in cases where people are put in hotel accommodation in rooms that have been described as their cells, it would literally save lives. I think it's particularly true, all of those quotes, for asylum seekers across Scotland, but particularly for those who live in rural communities, such as many of the rural areas in my West Scotland region. Obviously, there are higher costs to provide concessionary travel to individuals in rural areas, and it's why committee wanted to recognise the importance of the scheme being properly designed, properly tested and properly costed. And I think everyone in the chamber is agreed that we have to do that. I welcome the recognition in the motion of calls for access to bus travel by the Scottish Religious Leaders Forum. One of the things which I heard when speaking to people currently in the system was indeed challenges with getting to a place of worship, for example, which, as we all know, is a fundamental human right. I also heard about the ability to access services provided by faith organisations, such as the Jesuit Refugee Service in Glasgow and the excellent ESOL classes run at St Aloysius Church in Garnet Hill. And indeed, I look forward to visiting that service soon and discussing the work that we are doing in this chamber to try and improve access, not least through ensuring people can get transport to those services. Conscious of time, Deputy Presiding Officer, and so really to conclude, I welcome this debate. I welcome the work that's been done by committee and the strong recommendation. And I look forward to hearing from the Minister on how we can move forward quickly with an enhancement of the National Concessionary Scheme to ensure that people who are seeking asylum are afforded basic human rights and dignity that I think this would provide. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. O'Kane. I call Mark Ruscoe to be followed by Katie Clark. Mr. Ruscoe.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And I would also like to thank Paul Sweeney for bringing this important member's business to the Chamber today, and also to pay tribute to the incredible activists who've been driving this campaign over the last 2 years. I know many of them are in the Chamber here today. And for me, it's their testimonies that have been deeply moving. And I'm sure it's thanks to them that many of us are here in this debate here today, amplifying their voices. Now, it's not going to be any surprise to many of my colleagues to hear me talk about buses. I am incredibly proud of the success of the extension of the concessionary bus travel to under 22s, with millions of young people now signed up to that scheme. We've been shown exactly how transformative free bus travel can be. All young people under 22, including those seeking asylum, can access this concession, and it is undoubtedly making a huge difference to their daily lives, especially in the middle of a cost of living crisis. But extending this scheme to all people seeking asylum would be a real and tangible step. It would make a huge difference to a community forced into poverty by the Home Office. And I use the word forced here carefully, because people seeking asylum are forced into poverty because they are not allowed to work. Instead, they must rely on a limited form of housing and support from the Home Office. £6 a day for all essential living needs, clothing, travel, keeping in touch with loved ones, toiletries, school supplies for their kids, food, and so much more. And this is barely 58% of what anyone else would receive on universal credit. And those living in hotels only get £1.40 a day. Now, I know that in my region, there are more than 100 people in Perth who are in that situation. And in Perth, a day bus ticket is £3.90. To travel by bus from Perth to Edinburgh and Glasgow, a ticket is £9. So travel is completely unaffordable for somebody just surviving on £1.40 a day. And over the last few years, it's become painfully clear how inadequate this so-called support from the Home Office is. We've seen the UK government force torture survivors into squalid camps on ex-army bases. We've seen folks forced onto repurposed barges, better described as floating prisons. And we've seen people stuck in hotels here in Scotland, sharing rooms with people they don't know for months on end, unable to access the services and the support that they desperately need. Asylum is, of course, reserved to the UK government. While we may want to dismantle this hostile environment in its entirety, we cannot legislate to do that in this place yet. We do, however, have the powers and the responsibility to mitigate some of the worst harms caused by UK government policy. And the Scottish Government has shown leadership in protecting people seeking asylum through the limited powers available. But extending free bus travel must be part of that safety net. We've also now got the evidence of how the scheme might work and the impact it could have. The Scottish Government funded a pilot in Glasgow, and we've seen similar schemes in Aberdeen and Wales. And the evidence is clear. 100% of participants in Glasgow said it had a positive impact. And every single pilot that there has been so far has recommended a national rollout of free bus travel to all people seeking asylum. Now, I know that the Minister is actively considering both the outcomes of the recent pilot and the options going forward. And I want to take this opportunity to thank the Scottish Government for their constructive engagement with myself, Paul Sweeney and Bob Dorris and others over the past 2 years. But I will end with this. We don't need any more evidence to show us how much this intervention is needed or the impact it will have. We don't need any more evidence. In the words of a pilot participant in Glasgow, this ticket is a lifesaver. So yes, the route to implementation may be challenging, but we have to get this over the line. That is our responsibility as a country proud to protect all those who seek safety.
Thank you, Mr. Ruscoe. I now call Katie Clark to be followed by Bob Dorris. Ms. Clark.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I congratulate Paul Sweeney on securing this important debate today and also thank him for his tireless campaigning on this issue. Most of us in this Parliament agree that the UK is presiding over an asylum system which treats asylum seekers inhumanely. Earlier this week, I visited the Riverside Hotel in Erskine, which currently provides accommodation for around 160 asylum seekers. And it was clear from the discussions that I had there that travel costs remain a major financial burden facing asylum seekers. Under current Home Office rules, as we know, asylum seekers are prevented from working, even though many asylum seekers have skills that we need. At Erskine, they receive a £9.50 payment to cover essential costs, including travel. As Paul Sweeney and others have indicated, many receive far less at other sites. It was clear that a lot of work had been done at Erskine with the staff undertaking work with Renfrewshire Council to ensure that young asylum seekers at the hotel were provided with concessionary bus travel through the scheme for 22 years and under. This allows about 10 asylum seekers at that hotel to have bus passes. However, that obviously means that the remainder and the majority are ineligible for any concessionary travel schemes currently offered. Given the location of the hotel in Erskine, asylum seekers at the hotel will often have to rely on bus travel to reach other parts of Renfrewshire or indeed Greater Glasgow, for example, for college. They often need to travel to have appointments with their lawyers, to access volunteering, or as I've said, education, but also to connect with other members of their community who live further afield. And of course, we need to be aware of the language issues, with many asylum seekers not yet having good English. Yet bus fares in the Erskine area can be as high as £5.20 per day, which is over half of the £9.50 payment given to asylum seekers. The recent Travel Choices trial, which took place in Glasgow earlier this year, highlights the positive impact that free bus travel can have for asylum seekers. It's clear that free bus travel for asylum seekers can work, and it's crucial that we encourage integration from day one. I would be interested in her response if the Minister was able to outline any work that has been done on costings of this scheme to enable further discussion. I think it's important that this Parliament does use the powers that we have available to us to ensure that asylum seekers in Scotland are treated as humanely as possible.
Thank you, Ms. Clark. And I now call Bob Dorris. Mr. Dorris.
Presiding Officer, I congratulate Paul Sweeney in securing the debate this afternoon, seeking to secure free bus travel for all asylum seekers and for his ongoing dedication to the campaign. I also thank the Voices Network and Mayoral Integration Network, which is based in my constituency, for their dedication and tenacity for leading the campaign also. I also thank MIN more generally for the wide range of other campaigns they show leadership on and the support they offer migrants in the north of the city more generally. It's great to see them here this afternoon also. But let me be clear from the outset, I support this campaign and we must find a way to deliver free bus travel to all asylum seekers. I've been pleased to work in partnership with colleagues on a cross-party basis, particularly, of course, Paul Sweeney and Mark Ruskell. That partnership work is a key strength to the campaign. However, the most compelling strength of the campaign is the lived experience of our asylum-seeking community. It's absolutely clear that the UK Home Office does not come close to supporting the most vulnerable people to meet their basic needs. They are forced to survive on as little as £45 a week, as we've heard, little more than £6 a day, and little more than £1 a day if they stay in a hotel, and they're denied the right to work. I regularly see the impact in my constituency on asylum-seeking individuals and families of not having enough funds to live on. Struggling to buy day-to-day items people take for granted, living in temporary accommodation, and often struggling with a variety of underlying health conditions, often living in trauma. The day-to-day reality for many asylum seekers is deeply challenging. Simply getting on a bus is an unaffordable luxury for many. That is why it is very welcome that asylum seekers in Scotland under 22 and over 60 have full access to the Scottish Government's National Entitlement Scheme, but we must go further. Given the financially precarious and fragile situation that asylum seekers are living in, and given, quite frankly, the appalling support offered by the UK Government, it is right that we should look to extend free bus travel to all asylum seekers. I know the Scottish Government agrees. The recent free bus travel pilot project funded by the Government and run through the Refugee Survival Trust demonstrates that commitment. It may have been small in scale, but it was powerful. The analysis of the pilot project also clearly demonstrates the powerfully beneficial impact that having free bus travel delivers for our asylum-seeking community. Surveying the 150 participants in the pilot, we saw that there was a 38% increase in those using buses every day, up to 72%. 92% of participants travelled more frequently and 88% took longer journeys. Most journeys allowed asylum seekers to make appointments, sometimes relating to their asylum case, sometimes for other reasons, perhaps for health visits. Journeys were also used to be able to meet with family and friends, a clear benefit for tackling social isolation and promoting positive mental health. 1 in 5 journeys were taken for shopping, and given the limited budgets asylum seekers are living on, that's really key and important also. One asylum seeker said, and I bet I can't find the quote now, Presiding Officer, yes I can, after the pilot, they said, 2 things changed, mental health improved and I saved money. More available for activities with my son to watch him play football and able to use food banks. Isn't it a pathetic society we live in? We have to give someone a free bus ticket to get to a food bank because they don't have enough money. We must do better and we can do better. I know there are budget constraints in this place, but we must find a budget consensus and must deliver on this campaign. I know there must also be complexities in delivery, Cabinet Secretary, or else why on earth would Wales, who I really welcome their initiative, extend free bus travel to refugees but not asylum seekers? So there must be complexities. I say to my friends who have contacts with the UK Government, if there are complexities in delivering this across Scotland, work with us to make sure we can deliver it in budgetary terms and in practical terms. It simply must happen, Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Mr Doris. And I now call on Minister Fiona Hislop to respond to the debate. Minister.
Presiding Officer, I want to start by thanking Paul Sweeney for bringing this debate to the Chamber. I know that he has taken a keen interest in this issue for some time, particularly in his current role as Convener of the Cross-Party Group on Migration. There are a number of members who have consistently raised and supported the interests of asylum seekers fleeing war and persecution, not only in this parliamentary term, but in previous sessions too, among them Bob Doris and Mark Ruskell. I thank all members for their contributions. Many here will be members of the cross-party group and fully behind the campaign to make all people seeking asylum in Scotland eligible for free bus travel under the concessionary travel scheme. For my own part, I can reflect that on becoming Cabinet Secretary for Education in 2007, within months I had established a means by which children of asylum seekers who had been living in Scotland for the requisite time and met the academic grades would be eligible for home fees and subsequently free university tuition. This was at a time when many families had had to wait 5 years or more for their applications to be processed and could only go to university on prohibitive international fees. So I too come from a tradition of working out what can be done to provide support to people seeking asylum living in Scotland. I and my officials are in the process of working through a number of areas which need to be addressed to progress our commitment to work with third sector partners and local authorities to consider how best to provide free bus travel to asylum seekers. Firstly, is there political agreement to do this? From what I have heard this afternoon and from our earlier programme for government commitment, I think that there is clear cross-party support for action in this area. Among others, we've heard from COCAB Stewart, convener of the Equalities, Human Rights and Civil Justice Committee, that the report by the committee published on Tuesday supports an extension of the existing national concessionary scheme to include all asylum seekers and views that this would be a transformative effort for people in Scotland seeking asylum. However, in recognising the shared appetite to make progress, I know members will also recognise that the provision of free bus travel is more complex in delivery and there are factors which require to be further worked through, and we must ensure that the introduction of free bus travel would not have unintended or negative consequences for people that we all agree we are seeking to support. So that also takes me to highlighting practical issues in considering how free bus travel could be delivered to all asylum seekers in Scotland. Amending the statutory concessionary scheme will require secondary legislation, and we should weigh up the merit of local schemes for those asylum seekers who currently don't qualify. And that is why I'm interested in work undertaken as part of the local pilots in Aberdeen, Falkirk and Glasgow, which showed clear evidence of the benefits that access to free bus travel can offer asylum seekers. And I'm carefully considering their conclusions in weighing up how best to proceed. A further consideration is what powers do the Scottish Government have in this area. Everyone today will recognise that this needs to be fully worked through as proposals are developed. In broad terms, immigration is reserved, but integration and transport are devolved. We understand that the Welsh Government and the Northern Ireland Executive are both considering the question of provision of travel support to asylum seekers, and we are liaising with both on shared interest in this matter. Finally, I want to come to funding. This has two dimensions. The first is how the Scottish Government might fund what would amount to be a recurring annual cost. It is estimated that extending the concessionary travel scheme to all people seeking asylum currently in Scotland could cost between £1.3 million and £3.2 million annually. The variation in these estimates is due to uncertainty around expected take-up of the scheme and potential levels of patronage and would increase with more asylum seekers being dispersed here, as is planned by the Home Office. The budgetary pressures in the current financial year are such that there is currently no funding to help support this proposal, although the other issues to be worked through would be unlikely to be resolved fully during this period in any case. Yeah.
Paul Sweeney.
Thank the Minister for giving way on that point, and I recognise some of the complexities around no recourse to public funds, though Just Right Scotland have offered helpful legal advice in that regard, which I hope has been noted by the Minister and her officials. On the issue of costings, would the Minister be happy to share the detail of the different proposed models so that we can all have visibility of what has been proposed and the detailed working of those costings?
Minister. Thank you. I note the first point. I'll come back to the second point. The second dimension of funding is what effect any proposed provision in this area from the Scottish Government could have on current UK government support for asylum seekers. That's been flagged by that intervention there. But also it might affect the support currently in the small notional travel element. You will know that the Home Office is responsible for providing asylum support payments. The Scottish Government has no control over the rate applied. And I know that members in the Chamber and others would like an immediate answer to all these points. That is not possible now, but I can assure you that we are actively working through them. The Scottish Government is clear that people seeking asylum should be supported to integrate from day one of arrival. That principle has been set out in the pioneering approach of the new Scots refugee integration strategy for the past decade. The Scottish Government has repeatedly called for the UK Government, who are responsible for decisions of asylum, including dispersal policy, to ensure that the financial element of support provided to people seeking asylum reflects the real costs of daily life, including digital access and travel costs. Historically, the UK Government settled people in and around Glasgow, and a support infrastructure has grown in this area over the years. However, the Home Office introduced full dispersal policy in 2022, presuming asylum accommodation could be procured in any local authority across the UK, and asylum dispersal is now taking place outside Glasgow. Therefore, if there is a greater need to help support travel to access essential support services, such as legal advice and applications, this will need to be across all areas of Scotland if we are serious about supporting every asylum seeker to integrate into society and feel at home in our communities from the day they arrive. President Officer, I'd like to thank all contributors to today's debate. I have discussed this issue with Emma Roddick, Minister for Equalities, Migration and Refugees, and we agreed that despite not having all the levers that we would wish to be available, and despite some of the complexities that I've touched on, we are determined to continue to explore every avenue to provide the support that people seeking asylum in Scotland so obviously need, and to help them in their journey in Scotland and to a better future. But I must stress that we must consider unintended consequences, which could potentially cause more difficulties than it resolves for those that we want to help. I am meeting representatives of Maryhill Integration Network and partner organisations, including the Voices Network, Just Right Scotland and the Scottish Refugee Council, on the 14th of November to hear firsthand about the lived experience of people seeking asylum located in Scotland. And finally, President Officer, I will also be extending an invitation to interested MPs, MSPs, to discuss this issue in more detail with Emma Roddick and myself. I look forward to working with you all to put in place the right support for those who come to Scotland seeking safety.
Thank you, Minister. That concludes this debate, and I suspend this session until 2:30 p.m. Thank you.